So I asked Jesus, should I keep taping? And I opened up A Course in Miracles, and right there, the first thing my eyes hit, totally unambiguous statement says, I want you to share your ideas. You strengthen your ideas by sharing them. And this is what I'm calling upon you to do. And if you teach by sharing ideas, and it was just like unbelievable. Powerful, powerful statement. It says, absolutely keep sharing these ideas. But I'm very nervous these days, almost like on the edge of a nervous breakdown. I can't say, I haven't been able to shake it. I saw someone, a friend today, and I said, how you doing? And he says, well, I'm just hanging in there. I said, it sounds like me. I said, above all else, though, don't abandon your good habits. Stick with your good habits. He kind of looked at me and said, nah, yeah, that's the hard part. Meaning, maybe he was having a hard time doing so. He's an alcoholic. Had a problem with drinking, I believe. And so I was wondering, wow, I wonder if he's gone back to drinking. I hope not. It seems as though right now that we're under so much stress that there's a lot of pressure to go back to bad habits. I'm feeling that and have to battle against it, right? So I'm trying to keep all my habits going well. I'm eating too much right now, and I've got to start making an all-out effort to turn that around, which is up and down the effort. It seems like everybody I talk with, I say it's up and down. I say, yeah, that's how it's going right now, isn't it? It's one day you feel like, ah, oh, okay, I got it. Next day, wow, I really don't have it. What's going on? That's probably be expected when you transition into the new way, a new phase, a new. This is really, we've really moved into a different, a new dispensation at this point. We really have, and so it's kind of a little bit unsteady to say the least. But anyway, Jesus wants me to keep on sharing the ideas, and so I'm trying to stabilize my own mind and been struggling with this, and some help has come in the way of course, the wow practice, but I kind of forgot how to do it. I'm thinking like, wow, but what's the power of, where's the power of it? I kind of and then I had to really focus in on this, and so I'll share this idea with you. It's quite an extraordinary idea, and we could start out by saying that the way that the wow works is it calms our mind. It simplifies our mind. It calms by great simplification. And so what we're trying to do here, it's really an act. It's practicing. It's not theory. It's practice. And we have to volitionally, voluntarily, with our will, decide that the sum total of all our reactions that we have to whatever's going on right now, that sum total of all reactions, everything that we could think, thoughts, emotions, whatever the reactions, whatever the form they take, the sum total of all of that is wow. So we're able to experience right this moment the sum total of any and all reactions that we could have, not only to what's going on right now, but to everything that could ever happen. So you can extend it that way. And you basically say there is one final total summation for every last reaction of thinking of between in hope and fear that I'll ever have, even in a trillion, trillion, billion, zillion years. And that's wow. That sums everything up. And so we can have this great summation this right this moment, right this moment. And when we accept this, we just feel like a weight is taken off of us. And it lightens us up. We don't have to go through any of that stuff. We already have what it's getting to, which is wow. We've already arrived at the total summation. So I'd forgotten this. I'd given this information out before, but I'd forgotten under the stress of the times, which are, I've stopped paying attention to the news, so I don't know exactly what's going on at this point. Which is great in some ways. And so God is wonderful. It's giving us this information and help. Last night, extraordinary dream. I dreamed that there was this book with all these pictures of Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma that I'd never seen before. And I'm just like, wow. In so many different aspects, just so I was just looking at all these pictures and what? This is amazing. So extraordinary. I don't know what to make of that. Anytime you have a dream with a Dharma king involved, it's very auspicious. And I'm having them now. This last week has been amazing. Someone asked me, "Well, how's your week been?" And they said, "I like to be, think big. How's your week been?" I said, "It's been up and down." It's like, wow. Yeah. But then I looked back and I thought, it's been absolutely extraordinary. But almost too extraordinary, really. Almost more, really more than I can handle. Really on the edge of just collapse. I'm feel so weak because my nerves are really weak, and so physically, I could hardly like bend over and straighten back up again. It's like I feel like an old person suddenly. So, this is the a benefit of being in great shape, is you can withstand these tremendous shocks to the to your expectations without just crumpling. And so I'm still able to function, but I feel like barely alive, so to speak. But I'm still working out. I worked out. I'm trying to keep my habits going. Like everything is even keel. Just keep even keel. In the ups and the downs, make sure you have your habits. Make sure those stay steady. Very important. Very important. I ate an entire bag of popcorn today while driving. I said, what are you doing? I said, I don't know. I'm just you're trying to feed the anxiety. Try to make it go away. I gotta stop that. So, I worked out this evening, and then so I made this after workout shake, and it's what is it the it's like one of those you buy it in the health foods like Whole Foods or a good store with a I think it and it's a berry mix really high antioxidant kind of berry drink, and then I added tart cherry juice and then chocolate protein powder. So that's a very good recovery drink right there. So, I said, okay, let me do something, go back to, what I was doing before. And so I got a whole bunch of these drinks and of different types that are really supposed to be very, very healthy for you. And I'll mix them with cherry juice and maybe some chocolate protein powder and start going back to this liquid diet. Stop eating so much, snacking so much. I'm snacking now. That's a bad habit. Should go back to the 6 and 6 habit of don't eat anything after 6 p.m. So I'm gonna probably try to institute that again. So I'm, getting back to the core habits, and it's amazing how we can start drifting away from all of that. 6 to 6 is a powerful. If you really want to lose weight, that's the way to go. 6 to 6 and smoothies. Nothing, eat nothing after 6 p.m. I've got to start holding myself to that again. I've done it many times before, and just now, there's a sort of a got away from that. The workouts, I'm still doing it, not as much, not quite as strong as before, but I'm starting to gear up, going back in that direction. Not all out, but still, still doing the stretching, the weights, everything. But not quite as intense as before, because I feel so tired, very tired, and not sleeping well at all. I'm waking up at like 1 in the morning, 3 in the morning, and have a hard time get back to sleep. Real bad trouble with sleep cycles. And it's just like, wow, what is going on? Well, obviously we know everything's going on. So stick with your habits, okay? And get back. See if you can. Move yourself back towards, the really, really good habits that you have. I told my friend, he said, "Wow, that's I'm having a basically sort of indicate he's having a tough time with that." And he said, "Just hanging in there, barely just hanging in there." Wow, yeah, that's how it's been for me this week. Just amazing, but God has gotten me through. I said, I don't know how I'm going to get through work. I don't think I can handle it. And somehow he's given me enough space to do it. So if you're struggling, you are not alone. Everyone I talk with almost is feeling it, is really, really feeling it. And so I had to stop some things. You know, that said, I said, I better cut that out, stop that. I was thinking of stopping taping, but then again, Jesus said, no, share your ideas. So we'll see what we can do. But there may be some things I shouldn't say. I mean, people are very, very fragile right now. So probably just keep it pretty positive. This morning, I woke up 3 in the morning and I started doing practice. And it was the best practice I've ever had in my life. So that's how my days are going. It was the I have no value practice. I have no value whatsoever. I did it better and better and better and better until finally I said something that was so great, it was like my whole psyche suddenly turned into this piece of like paper, this one loose piece of paper sort of thing. It was just like floating in the air. And I just realized, oh my gosh, this is so amazing. I forgot what I said, but I was shocked by it. That's so. This is really profound. This type of practice, where you really point out that the I, you know, is you get used to seeing that the I has no value. It's worthless. It never will have any value. And you ultimately you're kind of getting used to saying goodbye to the notion of an I. Is what you're doing. It's just. But in a nice way, you know, it's like, y'all come back here, but not right now. Not right now. I gave that advice to a friend who has a cold, and they say, it just won't go away. You know, it keeps teasing me, but it keeps coming back. And I say, look, just be really nice to the cold and say, look, you know, thanks for coming. Really appreciate it. Appreciate the visit. And I've got some other stuff I got to do right now. So, but, you know, we'll see you later. But, you know, ease the cold out the door very nicely, but they said, you know, maybe we'll see. Let's see on down the road, maybe. But just not right now. Just not right now. And we should do that with our anxiety. Also, I'm trying to think of doing this. Just, you know, thanks for showing up. I really appreciate it. Big help. And so we'll check in with you a little bit later. Not right now. I need to move on briskly, so we don't need it right now. But we'll, you know, hopefully you come to visit again sometime. Just not right now, and not too soon. Good old Southern hospitality. I'll come back here. Yeah, I'm glad you're leaving. But they would never say that. Yeah. Hey, I'm glad you're leaving. I hope you don't come back anytime soon. But we don't say that. You say, hey, you know, it's been a privilege to have you here, Anxiety. Really appreciate you paying me a visit like this. And I hope we see you again sometime soon. But right now I've got some other stuff. So this has higher priority than the anxiety. So, you know, be this way. To your troubles, be very, very accommodating and nice, and don't get in any internal fight within your mind at all. Just keep it super positive. Yeah. And don't give up. Don't give up. Don't give up. Don't give up. We were watching the Warriors game, a Warriors Cavaliers game 3 of their NBA championships last night. It was something I haven't watched television like that in years. But I kind of got pulled into it, family sort of thing. I had to show up, and it was nerve wracking to say the least. It was the best basketball game I think I've ever seen. It was just from the very get go. It was just absolute pedal to the metal for both teams, and nobody would blink. It was just amazing. But the Warriors finally got behind. It looked like Cleveland had their number and was going to win the game. It looked very much that way. They're up by 7 points, I believe, with 3 minutes to go. But I asked those present, I said, so are you giving up or are the Warriors going to win? They said, no, the Warriors are going to win. And I said, you know what? I believe that too. They're going to win. And this is how they're going to do it. And they're going to make their shots, and the other team's going to miss their shots, and it's going to turn around right now. And lo and behold, that's exactly what happened. The Warriors scored the last 11 points, and Cleveland didn't make another point. They missed their last 7 shots or something. It was absolutely astonishing, but it was exactly what we both said. We said, this, you know, Warriors are still going to, they're going to win this game. They're going to win. But boy, did it look dark there. I mean, it looked really, really dark. And that would have, you know, ended their historic run at 14-0. They go 14-1. Now they're 15-0 in the postseason. A chance to have a perfect postseason. But it looked very, very dismal. But what happened? So what happened? What happened was they didn't panic. That's what happened. So it was a perfect example of being in shock but not panicking. And so they kept their poise. They kept their cool. They didn't get frantic. They didn't get desperate. They kept their intelligence. They did the right thing. They got the ball in the hands of the we call him the Durantula, Kevin Durant, and nobody can block his shot. You know, it's a good high percentage. Give him the ball, and lo and behold, you know, great things happen. And he made his shots, and it was an amazing turnaround. So, just seeing that, experiencing it, and we didn't lose faith at all. I was about ready to lose faith, and I said, "No, you know what? This team has proven that it can win and win and win and not lose. And so why should we give up on this team? Why should we lose faith just because they seem to be in a dire predicament?" It says, no, this team has the capability to turn this around. And it's exactly what they did. It was, again, that was just an incredible moment in basketball history, because I've been watching basketball for a long, long time. And that historic moment. So much writing on that. So much writing on that. And you know, basically, from going to be, you know, up 2-1, which they were last year, that's what happened. The Cleveland won the third game, and then Cleveland went on to win the series. And now suddenly it pivoted to being up 3-0 and having a chance to sweep the postseason and make history. It was just extraordinary pressure on that moment. And the Warriors handled it like champs. Like all-time great champs. And so that's when you know you have the right stuff. When you don't lose your poise, you don't panic. The fans are absolutely going berserk there, you know. And in the last 3 minutes of the game, the fans were just absolutely stunned. Absolutely stunned into silence. From 3 minutes before, they were, you know, they were lifting the roof. Delirious. And they walked out of there just quiet, just, you know, stunned. Astonishing. So we're in a situation, we may feel like we're down right now and really having troubles, and the opposition seems to, you know, have the best of us, seems like. But we're not going to panic. We won't panic. And we're going to, okay, you know, let's use our leverage. What do we have? Wow is what we have. So wow is the sum total of all reactions, all actions and reactions that we could possibly ever have concerning our situation right now. And the sum total, it all boils down to wow. It all boils down to just wow. And we have faith in this, okay? So we use this faith to just have this wow there, and that's all then we need. We don't need to go chasing after anything at all. Like clouds in the sky. Someone told me that today they were driving. They said, "Look at all the clouds. Isn't that beautiful? Oh, isn't that beautiful? Oh my God!" And I said, "Look, I don't want beautiful clouds. I'm driving. I don't want to be distracted. Okay, so I'm not looking at clouds. I'm looking at the road here." And it's like that right now. All these thoughts that we may have, reactions, it might be very interesting. And because there's a multitude of them, and we're kind of, the mind is just going off in all these different avenues, like, what about this, what about this, what about this, how do I, but we don't want that. What we want is just to say, it's just wow. I already know all sum total of all cloud formations is just wow, okay? And I already have it. I already have the answer. So I don't need to go chasing after anything. So we have the ability to rally, and we will. So we don't need to worry about how does a game turn out. We already know how it turns out. It turns out, wow. That's the feeling we have. We don't need to know who won or lost the game. But what we're after is the feeling, the overall impression that we get, the real core feeling, and it's like, wow. Meaning, wasn't that something? Wasn't that amazing? I mean, it's just, I don't have words for it. I really don't have words for it. So that's how it'll end up. But we really don't have words for how it'll end up. So we know it's just wow, okay? It's beyond words. So it's just wow. So it really makes time unnecessary. Really makes time unnecessary. Got my adjustable three, my 3-4 wood, they call it. It should be 2-3-4 wood or 2-3 wood. I don't know why they call it 3-4. It should be 2-3. It arrived a day early. I have it. And I cleaned it all up and took all the old labels off and everything and put it on 12D, 12.5D draw. And it's fabulous. You know, I just looking at it and swinging it and said, oh my gosh. Wow. Changes everything for me. It just says, oh my gosh. And I play this entire golf course in my mind and I just use this 3-wood. That's it. Didn't even use the driver. I said, well, I can play the entire course with this club. You know, wow. Amazing. Make it much more manageable. You know, take the risks out of the equation. Take the risks out of the equation. In a tight golf course, certain golf course, hitting driver is going to get you. You know, but if you use a 3-wood, you know, I feel like I can hit it really well. It takes all the trouble out of the equation. So if you liken like a golf course to like the times we're going through right now in the world, it's a very tight, treacherous golf course we're playing right now as we try to make our chess moves through these times that we're living in. So you really want to pipe it right down the middle. I mean, you really don't want to stray too much, right? You don't want to stray. And so you don't want to try to overpower the situation that's going on right now. You want to be very meek, very humble. Don't try to overpower. Better to keep the ball in the fairway. Okay, better to keep it. So you're calm. You know, you hit a drive and you might smash it 280. But it fades too little too much and rolls into the deep heavy rough and you're looking for your ball and you can't find it and your heart starts beating faster. Or maybe I lose it, or it might kind of roll into some scrub bushes or under some trees or whatever, and you start getting really stressed out. You're searching for your ball. That's no, and this starts taking effect on your overall psyche. But if you just pipe it right down the middle and you say, oh, I can see it and drive up just right, sitting pretty there, you know, it's like, oh. Walk in the park, no problem. Just keep it, you know, in the short grass, keep it. So this is in our lives, we need to just keep it simple, really basic. Don't try to overpower the situation. There'll be times when we can really, really go great, but we probably should be ease up a little bit right now. Be adjustable, you know, be flexible, be adjustable. And keep from oscillating, keep from stressing out one way or the other too much, really. So I'm doing various training, aversion. I'm doing aversion practice. It's like aversion practice is for bodies. So if I'm finding right now, you know, in a I, what I've found is that in a severe crisis, people tend to be attracted to one another. Just anyone, You know, I mean, a stranger, like you know, you're going through some like the terrible car accident or something, and a couple people stop and they're helping out, and it's just awful. And they're strangers, and they might feel strangely attracted to one another. This is what happens in a crisis, that people just want to cling to somebody, and if somebody acts like they're okay, and there's this terrible crisis, and other people are really suffering terribly, but you see, oh, someone else is okay, and you really is so easy to fall for someone under those circumstances. It really, 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 really is. It's amazing. So, but then of course later on you find, oh my God, what did I do? It's crazy. I was just any port in a storm, you know, any port in a storm. I just wanted to cling to something that made me feel, you know, something so not you know, it's a stress reducer, security blanket or something like that. Very odd dynamic, but I found that it is very true. And so what I've found is the crisis in the world is actually so severe now that bodies are starting to appear attractive to me. I said, what? Where's this coming from? I usually don't even think about it, but now, you know, starting to creep in, it's starting to creep on and recognize it. Hey, wait a minute, that shouldn't be creeping in there. So that's a really dangerous thing if you're thinking that bodies are attractive again. It's a sign of the times, sign that just shows that something's really, 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 we're really, really getting nervous. It's like people don't want to die alone, you know, they want to die with somebody. They go, oh, can't we die together, you know, at least like misery loves company. Well, that's not exactly that, but anyway, a crisis relationship, a crisis relationship. People, and sometimes in satsang, it's said that you know, there's so many crisis relationships going on because people are just in meltdown. They're going to the guru, said, guru, my life is just, you know, it's just, I'm in meltdown mode. It's horrible. Can you help? Help. There's a lot of people like that. They're just absolutely, you know, they're desperate. And when they're in that way, you know, like anyone who smiles at them, they think, oh my God, you know, it's so wonderful. You're so wonderful. And you get a crisis relationship going so easy. So just, and it's happened so fast too. It like hits you like an avalanche. So we, of course, we have these really skillful techniques here. Aversion practice is one of those super skillful techniques that anyone can use it, okay, and it's free, okay. Yeah, you could just do it, and I did it today, and it was like, wow, it was helpful. You just allow yourself to imagine something that is so repulsive that it just abhorrent, and you just immediately have to take your mind off bodies. You just absolutely, so you link up this bodies with some, you know, horrible stench and rottedness and pus and whatever, just slime, and it just absolutely turns your stomach like you want to throw up. And you do that anytime the idea of of attractive body arises. Any attractive body at all, you know, just use that practice. Use that practice, and just whew. And for me, it's like, ah, oh, don't do that. Oh my gosh, you know, oh, that's horrible. But I kept doing it, and that, you know, really is like shock therapy to get your keep. And sometimes when things get really dangerous, you have to do something like that. And especially with bodies, that's the most dangerous thing there is, actually. Attraction to bodies is the most ruinous attraction there is. It's the worst, because with that comes everything, all the other troubles, really. So it's certainly justified to use aversion practice. And occasionally I use that, but I now I've turned back to it and said, I better start doing this more frequently now, and you just really do it. I mean, it's not that pleasant because you're just grossed out. Said, ah, you see an attractive body walking along the sidewalk, and suddenly you imagine them, you know, all this hideous slime that they're dragging along, and ah, no, you know, I can't stand that image. You know, it's hideous. So you use just the most hideous imagery you possibly can think of that just revolts you. Okay, revulsion. Yeah, it's just that's skillful means. And in this way, you keep yourself from going down that most slippery path of all, which is attraction to bodies in this world. We're so used to that. It is impressed upon us to such an extreme extent. Watching the basketball game, when the commercials came on, I would, try to mute it and stuff, but occasionally they keep throwing stuff on you constantly. And you see some of it, and it's just hideous, the culture that is being presented on television. It is just repulsive beyond words, actually. Just absolute creatureness, absolute creatureness. There is not even a faint echo of any sort of dharmic attitude, practice, focus, etc. At all. At all. It's like devoid. Devoid of any spiritual content at all. Utterly devoid. They present every person on there is presented as a creature who instinctively is bound to creature lust and creature interest and creature reaction. Everyone is presented that way. And so people watching this constantly in the entertainment and in television and culture world of today, everyone is presented as a creature and subject to all the reactions of creatures as if they had no choice. It's all instinctive. It's just the way you are. As if you had no will to use skillful means to block all that. And it's extraordinarily wicked. What else? What could be more wicked than that? Than trying to convince all of us that we're mere creatures bound by instinct. Robots. I mean, nice consumer sheep, right? Easy to manipulate for the benefit of others. Power and control and profits, etc. So that was truly hideous. And this is what everybody is getting. So if you don't use skillful means, you're in trouble. Let's just be totally straight, blunt. If you're not using some skillful means of practice, you're going to be in too much trouble. So, by all means, use these skillful means. The wow practice is a super skillful means. The revulsion practice is a super skillful means. The wow practice, simplifying your mind, simplifying everything, so I've got the answer. I've got the answer that all my thoughts are looking for. Oh, I know what it is. It's wow. And that's the end to it. That's the end to all my reactions. So I don't need to go through any of them. I don't need to go tracing any of them. I've already got it. I've already got it. It's the sum total of all music, the sum total of all investigation and consideration and pondering and everything. It all ends up with just this feeling of wow, beyond words, wow. All of it. And you have that right now. You have it right now. You don't have to go to Yosemite to see what it's like, because you know what it's like. It's wow. You already have the total summation of the feeling that you're looking for. That's how it all shapes up. It all shapes up just as wow. All the fame, all the fortune that you will ever make in forever, it all boils down, will boil down and end up as the feeling of just this wow, okay? And we can experience that wow right now, right this instant, right this instant. So this is extremely skillful means. Totally free, right? Totally free, freely given. Just do it. Just do it. It's not an installment plan, I mean, it's free, right? Do it. Who could stop you? No one can. Just wow. But it takes an effort of will, and we can't be curious. We can't say, "Well, how did I get to wow?" No, we have to say we already have it, so we don't need to say how we got to it. It's ridiculous to say, how did I get to it if you already have it? You have it. And so to hold on to it is what's important. When you try to say, well, how did I get there? You lose track of it. You fumble it away. Because the whole purpose of it is to bring simplicity of mind. As soon as you go into, well, how did I get it? You've lost that simplicity of mind. You've lost that centeredness. It's gone. So the whole point of it all is negated by that. I arranged my golf bag today. I did some unique stuff and really interesting stuff. It looks great. It's looking like, wow. Like, who is this guy? It's different. It's like, this is sort of a different kind of fish here. But, you know, like, hey, this is going to be interesting. That gives the impression, like, this is going to be interesting. This is not just your ordinary golf bag here. Well, it's good. It's good that it's a little different, right? Aren't we up for that? Aren't we up for that? Yeah, we are. Sometimes I got to make sure there's not a mosquito on me, because they are out. That's why I'm wearing this long sleeve shirt and kind of trying to scrunch down in it. I don't want to get chewed on. Just like we don't want to get chewed out here in this world. We don't want to get chewed out right now. I did this innovation too in the golf bag. A really amazing innovation. I love it. I said, wow, this is great. This is what I'm looking for. So a lot of interesting stuff is happening that's been working on it for so long, and it just never came together. Suddenly it's come together, and it's just it feels like it's a different age now, you know. It's a different, we've gone into a new age, you might say, a new way, a new age. We've gone into it, if you want to call it a new age, you know, the new age. We're in it. We're into it now. We're already in it. And probably you're feeling it. And said, you know, it seems like it's a new chapter. It's really a new epic, a new era, a new global phase, a new world phase, a new age. We are in it already. And it seems like it's amplifying our habits and our direction and all this. It's amplifying it. So it's pushing us faster in the direction that we're going, is what this new age does. So it could be that there is a separation between the sheep and the goats, so to speak, is because, again, the direction we're going is really accelerated. So those who have gone in the creature route now, there's some people walking down the street. It just was incredible this afternoon. They were so creature, uncouth and creature-like. It was horrible. You know, very foul language and coarse crudeness, and I just, you know, they were just enmeshed in creatureness. It was amazing, and so that's what's happening now. Is those who believe that they're creatures will go super heavy into that, super heavy, that they're the very feral type of, you know, the Wonder Woman thing. Movie, I guess someone told me about that. That they said, "Oh, my daughters were enthralled by it, you know, and I loved it too." And then those of us, so there's something about trying to captivate people with creatureness, but the creatures have superpowers, you know. That's how, one of the tricky ways that we've been seduced, you know. Superman, Superwoman, Wonder Woman, you know, being a creature's fun because you get superpowers by being a creature. This is kind of how they're seducing people into creatureness. Those who are doing the seducing, which is really everyone in the world, are really seducing themselves. But this is what's happening. It's like, yeah, if I become like a real, really creature-like and really believe I'm just instinctive and stuff, relying on my creature instinctivity will activate some latent, superpowers in me, and I'll be able to, fight crime and stand up for judge, all this stuff, right? I'll be a super duper this and that. This is, of course, just outrageous lie that we're telling ourselves. We're not interested in superpowers, okay? We're interested in wow. Because boil it all down, our entire sojourn in this dream of believing that there's an absence of reality somewhere, and that from this we can become something different than what we are, all boiled down, it boils down to wow, okay? It boils down to wow. So we don't need any superpowers. We don't need any of that stuff. We don't need to. We just need to keep practicing these very skillful means. I was reading something by Longchenpa, the omniscient Dharma King Longchenpa, yesterday. It's super profound writing that not many are aware of. And boy, I read something I hadn't read before, and that was just amazing. It was just amazing. And then some other also another area of the book, another page that, and I just got it, I just could feel and I could relate to what he was getting at. I really, really could, better than I ever have before. I just said, wow, I'm, on the same page. I'm on that page. This is what I need to hear. And it went deeper than thinking about it. It was like I just could accept it. I saw it. I said I mentally could see it. What he's getting, I said, yeah, I really see that clearly. What you're pointing at now, have I accepted it or rejected it? I said, wow, I'm wowing it. Okay, wowing it. But at least I can certainly recognize it, which is great. Which is really, really great. So. Super wow for that. Super wow for that. So we don't need to try and, imagine superpowers and this and this and that. We just need to keep applying these skillful means. Use the three wood. In other words, don't try to be some superhero off the tee. That's the wrong message right now. Wonder Woman is the wrong message. For us it is. For those who are, hellbound, it's what the message they want. It tries to, motivate them to say, hey, yeah, going as fast as we can into creatureness is, that's going to work out great for us. What else can they say? They're rationalizing it. They're rationalizing their situation. Otherwise, they're going to panic, right? Because it's like, oh my gosh, I mean, is this really the right direction? And, well, everybody seems to be thinking so. And so sort of a collective freak out is going on. So they need to feel like it's really going to pay off for them. It pays off in mental illness, unfortunately, is what happens. So for us, we say, no, we're not going for the superpowers. We're just trying to keep it in the fairway. We're just going to practice this wow. We're just going to keep it simple. Wow, aversion practice. Wow, aversion practice. Wow, aversion practice. And affirmations, which are very powerful. Go easy on them. Don't overdo it. I have absolutely no value whatsoever. I, quote unquote, the I, has absolutely no value whatsoever. In other words, labeling, attaching a label to what doesn't exist doesn't have any value, does it? What kind of value does a label for what doesn't exist have? What value does the label have? Consider that. So the absence of reality doesn't exist. So what value does the label I have? just let that sink in. We're labeling what doesn't exist, what can never exist. The absence of reality can never exist. So why do we value this label? What value can it give us? What value can the label I give us? So we say, I has absolutely no value whatsoever. It will never have any value at all. It's completely worthless. I am completely worthless. Worthless. I is completely worthless. I am completely worthless. The I am is ultimately completely worthless. You know, saying this label is, the label for what doesn't exist is valuable. No, it has no value. We say it's worthless. It's completely worthless. And so the more you get used to this, and here you go, I know it's not easy at first, but the more you get used to this, wow, you realize I really am in a truly a new dispensation right now. Truly in a new dispensation. And great. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let me see, have some of this drink. Oh, so, yeah, I did my, what was it, 40 push-ups today? Or was it 30? those were really difficult ones. The bar was super low. I might have stopped at 30. I didn't want to, you know, burn myself out. I'm feeling kind of tired. But I still pressed myself to the point where I could hardly do another one. So, you know, it was just very difficult. Did those. I did these barbell lifts. We did only 20 of those. I normally do 40, but I did more difficult ones. And I don't want to strain myself too much. So you see how I'm backing off a little bit here, going with the 3 wood. Going with the 3 wood. Before, I would try to push myself beyond, you know, the point where you really hurt and starting to really hurt. And I said, okay, I can do 10 more, you know. And right now, I'm stopping before I get to that point. Just before I get to that point, I realize, hey, you know what? Let me stop now, and tomorrow I'll do it again. I don't want to push too hard at this point. So I think this is the gist of what we're getting at here, is we don't go all out right now. Okay, be really wise right now. Don't go all out. It's very tricky time. Very, very tricky time. And I've been like walking on curbs, you know, there's like a sidewalk and there's like an area for plants and then there's like a curb. And I, instead of walking on the sidewalk, I walk along the curb when the curb's like about, what would you say, 5, 6 inches wide or something. And this is balance practice. Now, it's not nearly as difficult as walking on a railroad track, which is more like about 3 inches. But still, it takes great concentration, really concentrating, and you know, I have to keep my balance, and it's a whole different thing than just walking along a sidewalk, but it's not as difficult as walking along a railroad track. So, again, backing off the intensity, the difficulty a little bit, but maintaining your practice, your workouts, whatever you're doing, maintaining it, but without not pushing it quite as hard. So that really has a correlation with hitting a 3 wood off the tee instead of a driver. You know, hit the 3 wood off the tee and you're going to get in a lot less trouble that way off the tee. Now you're not gambling, you know, and trying to crush the course, but you're trying to just kind of survive it and stay calm. So this is a very interesting way of looking at where we're at right now. And I think very important. It's worth repeating and repeating and repeating and repeating. And like, I'm not dieting super severely. So I'm saying, okay, I'm not going to try to get as low as possible. But let me make sure I don't just go too high also. So let me get down to 172 instead of 169 or something like that. Don't try to go to extreme measures, even extreme discipline right at this point. Just do go about 90%, or even 80 or whatever. You know, not full blast. So how did I feel with that 3 wood? Very confident. I said, oh, love it, love it, love it, love it, love it, love it at first sight. Haven't hit a ball yet, but first step is just to say, you know what? I love the way it looks. I love the way it sets up. I love how it feels when I swing. I feel I can really hit this great. You don't want to rush out and try to hit some and it's not your day and you hit some bad ones and immediately get a bad impression of the club. That's stupid. Because like today, I'm stumbling around. I feel so tired. I've tried to hit some balls today. I'd probably do lousy. And then you start saying, oh, this club's no good. And you form a negative first impression. So the best thing to do is don't hit any balls at all for a while until you really feel like, yes, I just love this club. I just love this club. And then even if you hit a few bad balls, say, that doesn't matter. I still love the club. So you have to form, you have to have a honeymoon period with something before you really put it through the very strict trials. And certainly don't go out on a course before you've gone to the range and grooved it and hit a lot of good shots and you feel, ah, this club's really great, I can really hit it great. If you go to a tough course, it might pressure you mentally in hitting some bad shots and then you start saying, oh, I can't rely on this club, I can't rely on it. So don't put yourself under too much pressure right now. Step at a time, step at a time, step at a time. So there's three steps there. First, feel like I really love this, but I'm not putting it to any test at all. I just like the way it looks. Second, take it out to go to an easy situation where you can reinforce the positivity you have about it. And only later should you even, if at all, actually right now, try to put it into real tough trials. Maybe we shouldn't even put it through really difficult trials at this point, actually. And that's a thought you should consider. And I'm considering that, not even putting it through. There's a course I could play, it's so difficult, and I think maybe I can handle it now. But you know what? Why even risk it? Why even risk that? And then forming a negative impression of the tools that you have. Why even risk it? And so that's an interesting question. It's been indicated to me, don't even try like to teach or encourage others publicly in person with other people, because that's like super difficult, super, super difficult. People are very, very fragile. It's super difficult in the best of times. Right now, it may be prohibitively difficult, and that would then cause me to lose faith in these practices that I love so much. So it's probably better now, to not do that, and keep faith and positivity about these practices and experience the benefit that I'm, having and give that in videos here. But don't hold like some sort of satsang or something like that. It's probably very much the wrong time for that. And then later on, when this new dispensation has settled down a bit, then perhaps, we'll see how it is then. We'll see how it is then. So I had a dream in where there's this barge, an aluminum barge, which can float in really shallow water, like 2 foot of water. So it means the times are really shallow. People are very shallow now, but this was able to float in this canal. And it has some sort of crane on it. I guess cranes lifts things up you can lift it up into a higher place, a crane, right? And it was aluminum, so it won't rust or ever tarnish or anything. And so it was meant for me. I was supposed to get on board, but in the dream I was talking to some people, physically present with people, a group of people, and we were laughing and talking about spiritual stuff and all this stuff. And then I turned it to I said, okay, I gotta go. And I looked, and the barge was gone. It was gone. And then I ended up having to swim in the canal. And it was real cold and terrible. It was a horrible experience. And finally I came out and there was these people. And they were Christians. They called themselves Christians, but they were like pagan Christians. And I was talking with them, trying to explain truth to them, and it was just awful. And then they invited me to a dinner, and it was hideous, the food they were eating. Bloody skin and all this stuff. It was like the most hideous creature food. It was like creature food. It was like what a tiger or a predator would eat after, felling some prey and gorging on it. That's actually what they were doing. They were gorging on this like prey, carcass. And they thought this was a delicacy. And they invited me like it was a great thing. And I was so hideously revolted by the whole situation. And so I realized that's what's going to happen. If you miss the boat now, you're going to end up in Creatureville, and they're going to be inviting you to come over and eat a bloody carcass with them, and they're going to be witnessing to you what they think is Christianity, and it'll just be like the most vile, pagan, egoic, nonsense possible, just hideous stuff. But they think that they're spiritual, they got it. So that really scared me, that dream. So I would say, wow, I better not do that. I better not interact with people at this point. It was the interaction that was the problem. So I could still tape like this if I limit the interaction in this way. Maybe, we'll see. But I'm not doing Facebook. I have not gone back to Facebook one time. I almost did, and I actually clicked on Facebook, and then I hit the login thing, and nothing happened. I had to reactivate my account. Nothing happened. It froze. The computer froze, and it wouldn't work. And then I realized that's the Holy Spirit saying, no, you're not going back there. And I say, thank you, Holy Spirit. Wow. Had a moment of weakness there. And because that was really, I could see what's happening to the world, and I said, wow, this is going to sink my ship. I'm going to miss the ship. I'm going to miss the boat here if I keep logging on to Facebook. I'm going to miss it. So I said, that's it, man. I cannot do this right now. Maybe down the road at some point, right? I'm not shutting the door forever on it. But at this point, it's indicated that is absolutely not a good idea, because you'll miss the boat. And we don't want to miss the boat, as I've just pointed out very clearly. What happens if you miss the boat? You are going to be hanging out with people who believe that they're creatures, and all that stuff that goes with it. So, which is horrible, horrible, horrible. You cannot imagine how I felt. I was just dismayed in to the ultimate degree. I just said, this, I absolutely do not belong here in the slightest bit. So, take heed. This super simplicity that we're practicing, hitting the three wood, backing off, not pushing yourself, just focusing on a couple of key practices and using those. You're not getting that on Facebook from anyone. You're not. Everybody there has their own ideas, and they're promoting them in this one or that way, and I don't find those. I like these ideas better. I like this practice. I like our focus way better than anything I found on Facebook. And so I'm not interested in being led astray or wasting time arguing with anybody, or, I'm sharing this and they're sharing that, and it's a mixture of stuff that just doesn't work. I mean, that doesn't benefit at all. I say, for those who are committed to a certain way or practice, do it, and do it flawlessly, okay? But we should not spend time dialoguing at this point and trying to come up with some hybrid between two different practices, or trying to convince someone from one practice to go to another, or anything like that. That wastes time. That wastes time. What's going on here? I don't know. Somebody's... All sorts of stuff's going on. We can't waste time like that. You just have to commit and say, okay, this is what I'm going to do. Fine, I'm going to hit the three wood off the tee. I'm not going to get engaged in back and forth and in uncertainties and stuff. I know what I'm doing, and I'm applying it to my own life, and I'm not trying to dialogue in any way with anyone about it. I'm committed to it, and that's it. It's like if you're married, you don't flirt around, That's it. It's like that. All that nonsense stops. 1 minute here. Everything okay? Okay. All right, so. Very important to understand this. You really have to just, at this point, have a plan going forward. Okay, you cannot be in the marketplace saying, "Wow, look at this plan. Oh, this like this. What? How about this?" And you know, trying all these shoes. You know, "Oh, I like these shoes. Oh, this." You know, you got to say, "Okay, these are my shoes, and I got to get walking right now. These are the shoes, and I'm walking. I got to be walking, so I don't have time to be shopping. It's not shopping time anymore. It's walking time." So I was hoping to help people and maybe have some people get interest them, et cetera, et cetera. But it became the returns became very, very, you know, negative. It was getting worse instead of better. So I said, "Look, it's up to the Holy Spirit. Whoever wants to come here will be sent here. I cannot be trolling the marketplace, you know, and saying, 'Hey, what do you think about this? What do you think about this?' And they say, 'Yeah, I like this. But look at this. Isn't this great? Maybe you should be interested in this. You know, everybody's a seller there. I'm not a buyer. You know, I'm not a buyer. I've already bought into this. Completely bought into this. So I'm not a buyer anymore. And Facebook, nobody, they don't seem to understand that. You know, I'm not a buyer at all. They just didn't get it. And they're not likely to be getting it right now at all, because you know the creature they're not able to use the wow. If you're using the wow, you're not searching and struggling and seeking at this point. You're practicing. You're applying the skillful means that you have gotten familiar with over the last however old you are. However long you've been here this time around, you've been working on trying to find some skillful means, right? Absolutely. So now is the time you must use those skillful means. No more shopping around right now. Don't shop around. So I was not really able to convince anyone that I know of to pay attention. Gave it my best shot, but I said, "Man, I can't keep doing this. This is, you know, it's getting really close." And yeah, it turned out, yeah, perfect move to stop Facebook, because now we know, in hindsight, we realize that, yeah, if you're not practicing and you're shopping, you're in big trouble right now. Because, the crisis relationships, you know, crisis relationships. What's going on in the world right now, just flames are being fanned by everyone possible in terms of the crisis, you know, for activism, this activism, that. And you will easily get pulled into some crisis relationship, form a bond with someone, thinking like, "Oh, you know, they're so wonderful, they're so beautiful," and get pulled into some sort of activism that way. That's what happened in the 60s, to be sure, for sure. It's the same old going on in the world, exactly the same, except worse. So again, make sure you practice revulsion, practice the revulsion practice for bodies. So that doesn't matter what body there is, it's just, it's revolting to you. The way that you're seeing it's just absolutely. I saw someone yesterday in a grocery store that I didn't need to imagine anything. And they're staring at me like that, like, "Who's that guy?" And I was like, "Wow. Oh, God." Maybe they were saying, "Hey, look how revolting I am. Why don't you use me as a model, you know, for revulsion?" Oh, holy cow. Talked to another friend today, someone, just an acquaintance that I've met a couple times recently. He's this man that came from Mexico, and he's really broken down, and he's just barely walking like a zombie, but he works really hard job, And I asked him today, you know, are you like a Vietnam vet? He goes, no, I'm from Mexico. I said, okay, he's thinking, he's kind of looking like a vet the way he is moving right now. And then he just kind of opened up. I talked with him, and he looks, he, at first glance, you think this guy's really not a good person, or there's something wrong, or but I, you know, I gave him the benefit of the doubt. I said, you know, no, I think he's just really broken down physically, and he's been working really hard his whole life and stuff. And he told me, he said, yeah, I've been here in the States, I've been working for 40 years nonstop, every day, 40 years basically. I mean, he is just, he said, I never miss a day, just 40 years grind. That's all I've done. And he says, I don't have anything. I said, he said, I'm thinking about going back to Mexico, but I've got family here. But I said, I can't decide which. I said, what, the quality of life? He says, yeah, it's about the quality of life. And he says, I got Social Security coming, but it's not enough to live on, which is certainly true, right? And I could totally relate with him because I'm in the same shoes. I got nothing, and I got a tiny bit of Social Security at some point. Not enough, you know, to remotely live on. And that's it. So I said, I'm in the same boat, kind of. I don't know where to go. You know, and he said, I can't decide what to do. And I just, you know, I gotta keep working. And so we really, you know, we were able to have this wonderful conversation about stuff that really important, just strangers to one another a couple of days ago. And you know, even though he, you know, he was just, you could tell he just battered by the life of tough labor, you know, tough life. But inside, you know, he's spirit. He's spirit, just like me. I've been battered too in different ways, you know. And so there's this mutual, you know, mutual respect there. You know, I get along with people like that very well. I can empathize with them. I really can empathize. And it's real, you know, the guy's really, he says, I don't know how long I can keep working like this. I got no choice just to keep going. But, you know, he's almost in the grave the way he's moving and stuff. And he said, I just don't, you know, what choice do I have? And it's like, wow. And I talked to another guy. I said, oh, you know, maybe I can beat the traffic. And you know, maybe it's a good traffic. He says, you can never beat the traffic here anymore. And I said, you're right. And of course, I didn't. I went out at 11 o'clock today, traffic jam. Unbelievable, terrible. And I said, well, it must be an accident. It was an accident, but there's always accidents here. And there's just almost nonstop accidents because people are texting, they're driving crazy. They can't stop. They're compulsive here. They can't stop. And so there's so many accidents. You just can't believe it. So whenever you go out, you're pretty much going to run into just terrible traffic now. You can't get away from it. Unless you go out at like 3 in the morning. Maybe that's why I'm waking up at 3 in the morning. I say, maybe I can go to work now, you know, beat the traffic. And maybe something like to do with that, actually. I don't know. I haven't thought of that. Yeah. Maybe 1 o'clock, you know, I don't know. But when there's nobody on the road, maybe I can get to work on time. So we missed this appointment, missed it, and have to go back another day because the traffic, the accident on the freeway. So, you know, it's like, so I really listened to that man. You know, maybe nobody's ever listened to him like that. I don't know, or someone like myself listened to him and just really heard what he had to say. I didn't have answers for him. But at least I really listened to what he had to say. And maybe he said, you know, wow, I appreciate that. Somebody, you know, at least treated me like spirit, you know? Like I'm a spirit, just like, you know, he is spirit, the same. We're the same. Doesn't matter. Our flesh doesn't matter. He doesn't know where to go. Well, who does know where to go actually right now? I mean, probably a lot of people don't know where to go right now in the world, right? Where do we go? Where do we go? What do we do? How, you know, how do we navigate, you know, the future? Well, it's wow. We already navigated it, and it turned out to be wow. Okay, so this is the power of wow, is we've already been through the future. Okay, Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit, Jesus says, has taken every single one of us all the way to the very end of our interaction with this, with our delusionary wish that there be an absence of reality, and to the resolution of all that where we decide to drop it. So the Holy Spirit's already taken us through our future. So why do we need to go through it? It's done it for us. The Holy Spirit's done it for us. And the answer is wow. Okay, it boils down to wow, and we can have that. We can hold on to that for now. When people say, well, we all die, I always say, well, sort of, you know. People are like, what are you talking about? I mean, I never really commit to what they say. You know, no, it's not really like that. You know, the Holy Spirit's already taken us through all our future and resolved it into right now. Wow. We don't need to do it. We don't need to do it. It's already done for us. We can do it if we want, but it's going to still turn out exactly the same. Exactly the same. Same answer. Trying to settle down. It's not easy. I mean, we might not settle down entirely these days. Someone I know just got locked out of their house. Locked out of their house. They can't stay there. There's a person, another person was staying there, changed all the locks, locked them out, won't let them in. Crazy. Stuff that's going on everywhere, right? So am I going to age? I'm going to get sick? I'm going to die? Not necessarily. Not necessarily, no. The Holy Spirit, well, I don't need to. Why? I have a wow. I have the wow. That's how it ends. I don't need to age or die because the Holy Spirit's already taken me through all that. All to the point where it's all boiled down to just wow. So if I have the wow, why do I need? I don't need anything else as far as dying or any of that futureness. I don't need futureness. Okay. So the new age might be the age when we let go of the age, the age, the future. When we realize we don't need the future anymore. We don't need a future. We don't need a future. That the real new age is when we realize we don't need an age at all. That's the new age that we're in, okay? The new age that some others are in is this super creature age, you know, with creature age of superpowers is how most of the world is going to treat this new age. So there might be like two new ages, kind of, one for those who go the creature direction, one for those who go the wow direction. I got this new swing, which is really flat, really flat. I really like it. Kind of correlates with flattening out everything, flattening out all reactions into wow. Very repeatable. Seems that my lower back seems to be okay. Upper back, lower back, it doesn't seem to hurt it. A little bit of stress on my knee, but you know, it's very interesting what's going on, right? The new age is here, but it's two ages, two different that are going divergently, very divergently. Those who believe they're stuck in a future, the future forever as creatures, and those who realize they don't need any future at all because of the Holy Spirit. grace of God. Oh, I'll tell you what happened yesterday. It was amazing. I walked into this house. I went to a house. I had to pick something up. And this Indian woman answered the door. It's a very beautiful Indian woman, extraordinarily so, but a very beautiful spirit. You know, just an exceptional being, actually, really exceptional. It's hard to describe, but very kind, very, very dharmic kind of, really dharmic type of person. And I was going to go around the side and everything. And she said, "No, you come through the house if you want. Go ahead and come through the house. It's okay." So I said, "Oh, should I do this?" "Okay." And went through the house. And suddenly I looked over to my right. And there's this big, huge Buddha statue with all this stuff in front of it. And it's like, I couldn't hardly believe what I'm seeing. I mean, these are Indian Hindus, you know, from India. And yet they have this look like they're Buddhists. I've never heard of such a thing. I've never heard any Hindus, you know, talk of Buddhism except in a pejorative way. So, I didn't say anything. I didn't ask her if they're Buddhists, but even if they weren't, they have this beautiful large carved statue of, I didn't see if it was Amitabha Buddha or Gautama Buddha. Gautama has one hand down and one hand up, and Amitabha has both hands up. I didn't quite check. It might have been Amitabha Buddha. And it seemed like they had sort of dressed it up. It seemed like there was something going on involved, more than just like a decoration. You know, but even so, why would Hindus have that kind of decoration in their house? You know, it's so extraordinary. What was it telling me? Stick with Buddhism and not don't spend too much time in Hinduism, right? For me, probably telling me that. I feel more comfortable in Buddhism, actually. With Longchenpa, I seem to really be able to get what he's saying and the discernments of Buddhism, of a really high Buddhist. I have ultimate regard for it, you know. Really, I do. Yeah, I just pray that someday I get to really spend more time with some great Buddhists, you know. Really, I could really benefit from that. The Longchenpa is one of them, to say the least. The discernments he makes and the way he presents it, you know, it's just, man, wow, what a wish-fulfilling tree that is. It's just hard to believe, you know, how clear they are in their discernments and presentation. I've never seen anything like it. I really haven't, not in other religions. I haven't seen anything that done like that. In a religious context, certainly Jesus in his A Course in Miracles, Journey Beyond Words, dialogue on awakening, has his own gorgeous, you know, wish-fulfilling tree of ultimate discernment and you know, fabulous presentation and all. No, certainly, which I also love, but it's not quite in a religious context, you know. It's outside of the Christian context, really. Whereas this is, you know, like is like Vajrayana Buddhism. It's still in a context, you know. It's amazing. Even though it's Dzogchen, it's a major religious lineage, Nyingma school of Tibetan Buddhism, and the fact that there's these many teachers who are able to present and teach this like this, it's oh my gosh. And I was driving down the street road 2-3 days ago, and I go past a telephone pole near here. There's a Tibetan prayer flag wrapped around the telephone pole. I've never seen that before here. And I said, oh my God. Yeah. Nyingma Master's in the house, right? Apex Array in the house. Longchenpa's Apex Array in the house. And they certainly are. So I would just love to spend some time, you know, with a great Buddhist master, you know, just to hang out and just to, you know, see how they present it, you know. Wow, I mean, the attitude and the style of presentation and how what how they are, what they're about, and the discernments, and how they just, you know, just the whole presence and ambience and everything about it, just to experience that. I read the Bodhidharma, rose from the grave. I didn't know that. That's how the story goes. So someone, after he died, someone was walking along, and there was this man, and he had one sandal, and he didn't know who it was, and they talked with him, and he came away thinking, wow, this guy is something else. I don't know who he is, but he's something else. And then he went to finish his journey, and then apparently he talked about this guy he met, and they said, well, that sounds like this Bodhidharma that died. And so they went to his grave and opened it up, and it was empty except for one sandal. So, I mean, you know, that's, yeah, sure, why not? Of course, we know that, like, what was it, Elijah ascended into heaven. Padmasambhava certainly said to have ascended into heaven. Jesus ascended into heaven. But as far as resurrections go, now we have Bodhidharma, apparently. If Jesus says a piece of cake, for us to do that, for spirit, the one mind to present a body after one body dies, to present a reappearance of a body, he says it's easy, simple, no trouble at all. One mind can do this. Well, then certainly others would be able to do it as well, right? Absolutely. In Tibetan history, there are teachers who have reappeared. Babaji is said to have reappeared. All right, so it's something that can happen if it's called for. Bodhidharma, you know, is this of the school of, you know, sudden enlightenment, thinking no thoughts, just, you know, like that. Well, as Jesus said, if your intent is to succeed and it's genuine in the right direction, you will eventually succeed. There's no doubt about it. There's many ways to succeed, he says, many ways. If you're thinking no thoughts, you're placing no value on thoughts, and you're placing no value on judgment, and you can then, for sure, you can see at some point the nature of mind itself, where samsara and nirvana are the same. It's the same nature of mind present in both samsara and nirvana. And that's really what Dzogchen is saying. And you can abide in that nature of mind without straying. We certainly can do that. We certainly will. At some point, we keep trending the way we are. And a dragonfly landed on my arm. Very rare thing. I was just waiting outside with my arms crossed, and a dragonfly just came and landed on my left elbow. It's a beautiful, beautiful, beautiful dragonfly. And it just stopped. And so I just stayed there. So I just looked at it very intently, very carefully. I said, huh. And then the dragonfly then crouched down like that. That was its message to me. And isn't that the message we're saying right now? Hit the three wood, not the driver. Go into refuge. Don't discourse with people. Keep your own counsel in terms of doing your practice. Crouch down. Lay low. Lay low. Lay low at this time. Lay low. Not completely out of sight. Okay, but lay low. And that's probably why my knee went bad. It's a way of keeping me low profile, because if I was totally healthy now, I probably would risk, a high profile, because I'd be so physically lively. But that's probably a disaster. It would be a disaster. So right now, this having a bad knee has helped me stay very, very humble and meek, and just say, no, I can't do that, no, I can't do that. Because if I had a healthy knee right now, I'd be able to do anything. I'd be able to surf, I'd be able to cycle, snowboard, hike, every so I'd probably be like getting into all sorts of groups and stuff, activities and everything, which is the wrong thing for me to do right now. Because people are inviting me. I said, I can't do it, I've got a bad knee right now. Why don't you go get into my mountain biking? I said, oh, no, I'd love to, but my knee, I got a bad knee, so I can't do it. Why don't you go to the beach? No, I got a bad knee, that walking in the sand hurts my knee, which it does. So basically, it saved me from getting involved in anything at this point. I really can't do much of anything. I play golf. I played golf, and it didn't hurt it very much. I was okay. It kind of gets a little sore. It's a little sore afterwards, but not terrible. But running is really bad. Like I was trying to get into jogging and running, and thinking maybe I can start get into like some short runs and stuff with people, and just be part of a group. And that just blew, my knee just blew out so bad. I said, what the heck? I was in really good shape, feeling really good, and just ran a very short distance, and the knee just absolutely fell apart. I said, that is weird. Didn't feel like I hardly put any trouble on it at all. So basically was saying, no, don't do that. Don't do that. Don't get into group activity at this point, because you're going to, again, it's a herd thing. Under stress, people are looking for this, crisis relationships. They want to form this codependent relationship. They just say, I gotta cling to this. I gotta cling to this. And reason goes out the window, and your skillful practice goes out the window. And you think, oh, I found a friend. I found all these friends. I'm close to these friends. Based on what? You're both having a crisis. Well, are they dharmic? Are they doing skillful practice? Are they doing the same skillful practice? You just forget about all these questions, which, I mean, is really stupid, because you don't want to lose your dharmic practice right now. It's like if you're in a swimming pool or a river, or you got water, you got to swim. You do the swim stroke that you're comfortable with. Like for me, it'd probably be like a side stroke. I can do that. And just keep my breathing, when you hold your breath and do it and do it and do it, and when you want to get a new breath, go like that real fast. So, because when you let out your air, of course, you start sinking in the water. When you have a full set of air in your lungs, you're floating. So you just have to really concentrate on your breath and keep it smooth, keep it even, and just sort of just glide like that with a side stroke, and then you can swim to shore. Absolutely, you can. But if you start saying, wait a minute, I need to do the butterfly, and I need to do the breaststroke, and I need to do the crawl, Austrian crawl, and I need to do the backstroke, and I need to do, all this kind of scissors thing, and the dog paddle, and you try to do all this different stuff, you're going to get discombobulated. Your breath will get all out of whack, and you're going to flounder. You're going to flounder. So when you really realize you're out to sea, lost at sea, got pulled out to sea by a ripped current, you just better focus on your breathing, make sure you're floating, and you're making a minimum of effort by keeping your lungs full, so it helps your buoyancy, and a minimum of physical exertion. You're not trying to go fast, okay? And then when you finally get down, so you can come in, you have to do it smoothly. Don't like panic and try to get in real fast and wear yourself out. You say, well, if it takes a half an hour, that's fine. I got all day to get into the shore. I'm just enjoying it, and I will just be calm and relaxed and enjoy of what's going on, and feel very positive about it. And wow, say, well, I know everything's wowish for me already. You see, everything's already wowish for me. There's nothing I can add to it. So that's called presence of mind, which is what the warriors did last night. Presence of mind. You just keep your your heart rate low, your breathing, calm and steady, are appropriate to the situation. You don't allow yourself to get all frantic, and like that right now. You get into a group that can easily stampede you into being frantic. It can easily stampede you into getting frantic and burning yourself out. So stick with this calm wow practice, and then block your attraction to bodies. Block your attraction to bodies. Do that a lot, as much as you need to do. Keep in mind that the best place for skillful practice is if you're poor, you have low position in society, no expectations on you. You're not really, whether you do good or not doesn't really affect anyone. You're just like sweeping the street or something, and poor, so you cannot try to buy your way out of your anxiety, where you realize you have no choice but to actually practice in a skillful way. You see, if I had money, there's no way in the world I'd be where I am now, because I would say, well, the answer to this anxiety is to take a trip, to Spain and play golf in Spain, or go to Costa surfing in Hawaii or Costa Rica, or there would always be something I would think I could do to spend money to get bail me out of how I feel. But not being able to do any of that, I have no choice but to say, the way I got to do it is to get the skillful mental means and do it by training my mind and my expectations. So that's what I had to do my entire life. I couldn't go skiing. I couldn't do any of this stuff. Very rarely, super rare, I realize I can't, don't have the money to do it. That's a super blessing to be poor in this world. It's a super blessing, as long as you're not really destitute. I've never been destitute. In a lowly position where, hey, you're here to sweep my driveway. Great, whatever. Okay, well, nobody expects anything of me. You're here to, you're gonna get the weeds out of my yard or whatever, right? Okay, yeah. I missed a few. Wow, whatever. It's not life and death. So nobody expects anything out of you. That's really important. So that way you can shock yourself by great success, which is what I've done. And then the other is just have a partner, a spouse, whatever, that you just, you're friends with, but you're just not romantically attracted to them really at all. And you just, no, not in, not, not, no romance. Romance is gone. So no romance in your life. That's very important. But you're committed. You have a committed relationship. That way you don't start, looking for some other body, which is what people do when they get really anxious, really desperate. How do I get out of this anxiety? Oh, let me look for some beautiful body, somebody. Oh, they're wonderful. They're wonderful. This, I'm wonderful this way. But just no, you're committed in a committed relationship for life, and so what if it's dull? Great. That's great. I don't have to worry about any of the romance or anything like that. Forget about it. It's out of your mind. Bodies are out of your mind. That's very important, to not have bodies in your mind. As I say, a boring wife, a great life. Wow. Like that. Yeah. A boring relationship is perfect. It's perfect. It really is. Stay in that situation. Stay in a boring relationship. Stay poor and stay very low status, super low status. And then, under that wonderful cover, you are able to have astonishing success towards dropping your valuing of a label for what that doesn't exist, what can never exist. Absence of reality can never exist. So we drop our valuing of a label. That's all we're really doing. All we're really doing is just dropping this valuing of a label for what doesn't exist. So it's super helpful to not be able to get your way out of the struggle, the shock of trying to do this by, diversions, diversions, diversions. Instead, we focus on mental practice, the right practice. It's good to be in a committed relationship if you are really, it's set. So, no thoughts, no flirting, no thoughts, none of that stuff, and even if you, crisis relationship, say, no, I'm committed, I don't stray, that's all there is to it. And you hold yourself to that. Very, very important. That's why it's part of most religions, you don't stray. You absolutely don't stray from the committed relationship. Because that sets the groundwork for good boredom, helpful boredom. Helpful dull life. So you can then say, well, I've got to get it through my spiritual focus, my spiritual practice is where I get my success and my stability. I get it that way. And I'm not looking for some vacation, or a fling or something like that. Horrible times, if you're not committed. It's crazy. The aggression and people looking for love in all the wrong places, looking for stability in all the wrong places. We get it through just wow. Wow is our stability. Because that is the sum total of stability that ultimately we arrive at in this attempt to label what doesn't exist. We finally get this perspective on it, a stable perspective, like, wow, it was just wow. It's all just wow. What I am, what I tried to do, that it didn't work, that I'm now through with it, wow. Just that. So maybe one day I'll hit the three wood, but not right now. I'm just going to, take it day by day, and one day maybe I say, yeah, I feel like today I can hit it really well. Go see if I can do that, and just get used to it. Go through a process of familiarity. Don't overlook this. So to go fast, you go slow. To go fast, you go slow. To go fast, you go slow. Whereas if you go too fast, the wheels come off, and then where are you? Then you stalled out. And when you stalled out, what's happened to your speed? It's gone. It's gone. So we need to keep a steady speed where we're continually every day, more and more and more and more we're feeling comfortable with losing interest in a label for what doesn't exist. Oh, I have a label for what doesn't exist. Wow. The world says, aren't you fortunate that we have a label for you for what doesn't exist? And it's so valuable, Here's your name it's I, but we'll call it, Joe or Jill or something, right? Oh my gosh, how lucky, how fortunate you are to actually, you have a special name for what doesn't exist. Oh boy, it's hallelujah. And God gave you that special name for what doesn't exist. That's they say that, right? God created this special label just for you for what doesn't exist. And you get to have that your whole life until you die. But if you keep it your whole life, guess what? You get to go to heaven. Okay. Wow. Madness. Absolute madness, right? Did God create us, spirit, to spend all eternity enthralled by a special label for what doesn't exist? The belief that there's an absence of reality somewhere? Is that what God created us for? Excuse me. No. To assert such nonsense is just simply having a fling with absurdity is all it is. You're having a fling with absurdity, and you're in a state of gross stupidity, gross absurdity.
Huh?
As the world turns, right? But we don't need it to turn.
Hold on. Huh? Soon, okay? I will. Don't worry. Yeah.
And but we don't need to see how the world turns, because we know the ultimate resolution of all its turns that we'll ever make is wow. And everything that will ever happen on this world as it's turning, the ultimate resolution is wow. That's how it all ends. That's what it all comes to. That's what it all arrives at, is wow. So we're already there. We've already arrived. That's saving a lot of time, isn't it? Saving a lot of frustration. Saving a lot of troubles. Saving a lot of miseries. Saving a lot of doubts. Saving a lot of you name it, right? Saving a lot of disappointment in not finding happiness for believing that you're a label for what doesn't exist. A special label. A really beautiful special label. A precious special label for what doesn't exist. And you're supposed to take that to the grave with you. It'll, say, guess what? And your reward for this is the grave. Yeah, is any wonder we got a lot of head scratching going on? A lot of drinking going on. People said, "Wow, it's tough. It's tough. Yeah, it's tough." So I get a special relation, a special label for what doesn't exist. I get a special relationship with some other special label for what doesn't exist, and then we get the grave. And then God's like really happy with it. Said, "You've done exactly what I asked you to do, and it's wonderful." That's kind of weird. It's kind of, I don't know, something really weird about all that. it's more than weird. It's completely lunacy. But our expectations have been turned in that direction so much, we have to be pretty cautious about, looking at this and having a good laugh at it. You don't want to go too fast. You don't want to go too slow. You don't want to go too fast. And of course, we're not mocking God. We're just pointing out the mockery of God. It's a mockery of God is what's going on. That doesn't mean there's no God. Just because this world is a mockery of God, and we see it, does that mean there's no God? No. I mean, that's a mistake somebody make. They can see it and say, this is crazy. But then they conclude, well, there's no God then, right? Because you're saying that God created the special label for what doesn't exist, and then you die, and you're supposed to be happy with that. They say that's nuts. Yeah, it is nuts. But then they say, well, that means that your belief in God is crazy. No, it doesn't mean that. It just means that we're mocking God. But certainly, there is all value everywhere always, which we say God, all value everywhere always. And hallucinating the absence of that doesn't mean it's absent. If we hallucinate the absence of something, it doesn't mean it's absent. It just means that we're pretending not to see it. We're pretending it's not there. We're desiring or wishing it wasn't there. So all value everywhere always, it's always. It's everywhere present, and there's no way It can't be present. That's intrinsic reality. So it doesn't matter if we wish it's not there, it's still there. We don't have the power to wish it away. There is no power to wish it away. Even God can't wish God away. So really, all blessings to the Dharma Kings, and let us not forget the high Buddhists, you know, the really great Buddhists. We are truly at a loss for words to express our gratitude toward what they have done and their efforts on our behalf. And, you know, we're doing our practicing, you know, really, we're doing our practicing. Same goes for Jesus, of course, all the Dharma Kings. And if we can coax, you know, some of these Buddhists to help us out, we'll be better for it, I'll tell you that. That's another spider. They're always moving somewhere, aren't they? Spinning some web. I don't know how they're doing it, but they do it somehow. Maybe they float their, you know, float their thread on the breeze, and then it attaches to something, and then they've got a guy wire there, and then they can start doing stuff. I don't know, but I'm gonna have to, I have to get out of this place. So, yeah, I had to sort of remove it from here. Whoops, it's now attached to me. Okay, God, no. Yeah, it is attached to me somewhere. Oh, it's still attached. Son of a gun. So I can get rid of it. Nope. Ah, amazing. No, it's still attached to my finger. As I broke the line, it got attached. Okay, now it's unattached. Amazing how sticky it is. Wow, it's incredible. So we're just hanging out here. I'm trying to do this, and Jesus asked me to do it. To kind of keep reassuring everyone, because it's a... Yeah, there's some hardball. It's a rough time, isn't it? It's a nerve-wracking time right now. Very much a nerve-wracking time, and we're feeling it. But again, hopefully this is reassuring and can, you know, sort of take the edge off of our troubles, realize we do have the practice, the awesome practice. And again, I'm really praying for some of these Buddhists to really come out in the open and give us an opportunity. You know, give us an opportunity. Yeah, we don't know what to do. I don't know Buddhism, how to practice it, really. But, you know, so give us an opportunity. We're willing, you know, we're willing to catch the breeze you have, you know. We have some sails unfurled, some dharmic sails unfurled here, so we want to catch the breeze. We need to catch the breeze. And they know, the top ones know that what it's all about. They know you don't have to do it this way or that way, or, you know, they understand if you got the gist of it, if you're that, you know, that's fine. They understand that. I'm not a tantric, Vajrayana tantric or anything, or visualizing anything or anything, you know, I don't do any of that. I just don't feel competent, you know, to do it. I don't. And I don't want to jump into something. You know, if you have a lama, and you live with them, be with them, you know, your whole life, that's a different story. But otherwise, I wouldn't try that tantric path, you know. No. I mean, you're really using powerful visualizations and means. You better have that lama, you know, right there having your back, and our culture has your back, and, you know, a lot of factors going for you if you try to really go that direction. You know, you start stirring up, you know, you start dealing with all sorts of expectations that are triggering all sorts of reactions and everything. And, you know, that's, we have our way of dealing with those expectations here. So I expect to stick with that. Expect to stick with it. But still, wouldn't it be nice, as the Beach Boys song go, to come across some top-notch, really top-notch Buddhists, you know, which I externally I never have. Internally, I certainly have. Asiatics can be, you know, grossly materialistic, or if they go really spiritual, they can be really very, very spiritual, actually. I love their demeanor of some of these Asiatic masters. It's just, wow, they have a soft gentleness to them that is really very, very extraordinary. We could certainly benefit from that, really benefit from it. I'm coming across a lot of Asian men just going out and around. There's so many Asians now in the Bay Area, it's unbelievable. It's like I've been inundated. But the ones I tend to come across, a lot of them, they're very humble and graceful, and their demeanor is amazing. I'm running across these, and it's just like, wow, what a... I guess I'm seeing with rose-colored glasses, you know, but why not? There's also the crass materialistic ones here, too, a lot of them. But that means they're nice people, but they're, you know, creature people, kind of, right? They're creature people. I mean, I get along with creature people fine, but I don't really want to hang around with them. You know, it's just like I say, you know, there's lots of, you know, there's different varieties of tea. Let's say, you know, you want to pick a tea, say like this. They all sound kind of good, you know, but not, I don't really feel like a black tea or this time, but maybe like an herb tea. But this one's a little too much for me, and this one's I want kind of a mild herb tea. So ultimately, say yeah, give me that one, nice chamomile tea or something. So I say that, you know, that's my cup of tea right now. So it's kind of like that. I mean, don't we have the right to choose our cup of tea without being called pejorative names or something? Of course we do. What the heck's wrong with this world? Does it, just because you choose something to hang out with a certain crowd doesn't mean that you're not saying the other crowds that aren't nice also? But I mean, you know, if you try to mix all different flavors of tea together, who does that? Who doesn't, you know, 10 different types of tea, and you put 10 different tea bags in, what kind of tea are you going to get? You're probably going to get something where there's no flavor taste at all. It's yucky. So, you know, why should we have to homogenize everything in this world like that? You know, why can't we choose our own crowd? We should have the right to choose our crowd. It doesn't make us, doesn't mean we're, you know, prejudiced against other teas, you know? It's just that for right now, this is the kind of cup of tea I want, because this is you know, what I feel like. This is, I want a cup of tea that I enjoy right now. That's doesn't mean the other ones aren't good, but this is the one that's best. Like ice cream, I feel like, you know, chocolate ice cream. There's, am I prejudiced against all the other flavors? No. But right now, I want to have some chocolate ice cream or vanilla ice cream, whatever, right? That's, you know, how can you argue with that? It's ridiculous. Because I hang out with people of every kind of ilk, you know, but I'd rather hang out with, let's say, some, you know, some great Tibetan Buddhist masters or Jesus or something. I'd rather hang out with them right now because I feel, you know, it would help calm me down more. And what I want is to be calmed down, and I feel they could do it. Whereas these creature people, I think they're going to stir me up in the opposite of being calmed down. That doesn't mean that I'm, you know, some other time and place would be happy to, you know, shoot the breeze with them, you know? Sure, I mean, I was talking to a bunch of people today, creature people, all different types, and I get along beautifully with them, but I prefer to, you know, hang out with some, you know, maybe Buddhist masters, you know, right at this point. don't think I'd want to stare at a wall for 10 years like Bodhidharma right now either, but I don't think they would advise that. They might advise something like stare at something for a little while. Whatever it is, I don't know. Maybe they would, maybe they wouldn't, but I'd certainly be willing to listen. I was thinking today, I was talking with someone about guitars, and someone said they're really a gearhead and they'd got all this stuff, and I said, oh yeah, I used to be too. And someone asked me, are you a musician too? They were kind of like beaking me, you know, in a friendly way. And I said, no. They said, you used to be a musician? I said, no, I used to be a lunatic. I'm not a musician. There's no such thing as a musician. There are lunatics, and then they're not lunatics. All right. I said, but I'm not a lunatic anymore. I'm not a musician anymore. But anyway, I was driving later. I was kind of thinking about, like, what if I did get back into music or playing guitar or something? I was like, oh, no, horrible. But then I thought, who would I want to play like? I was thinking, like, how do you play? I said, well, Eric Clapton. And then I said, well, but nobody can play like Clapton. It's crazy. It seems so easy to play like him, but nobody can play like him. It's a weird thing. You hear Clapton, immediately you just go, that's Clapton. It sounds fabulous. And he's just, but I don't, why does he sound so fabulous? I don't know. I asked myself, has anyone ever played like Clapton? No, I haven't ever heard anyone play like Clapton. A lot of people have tried, but they don't sound anything like him, really. There are people that sound like Jimi Hendrix, fairly close. But like Eric Clapton? So what is it that makes Clapton Clapton? You know, this is kind of something that's puzzled a lot of guitar players. Just his tone, he hits one note and immediately just go, ah, oh, yeah, Clapton. I could listen to you all night, you know. And where other players, you know, you hit notes, it's like, there's no reaction like that. How does he do that? It's one of the most amazing artistic things I've ever come across. So I started considering this. What is it about Clapton? And then I thought, well, why don't I take guitar lessons from him? And I said, well, what if Eric Clapton came up to me and says, you know what, I want to give you guitar lessons. Would you be interested? And I'd say, I thought about it. I said, okay. I said, well, when do we start? And he says, how about right now? I said, let's start. I mean, let's start. Are you kidding me? If Eric Clapton said, I want to give you guitar lessons, I'd say, okay, let's start this instant. I wouldn't turn that down. I wouldn't turn that down. Well, you know, I'm just as a metaphor. Maybe I actually would, but as a metaphor, if you're a guitar player and Eric Clapton offers to give you lessons, are you kidding me? And what I was thinking, what would the lessons be like? I have no idea. But I'll tell you one thing. You, just by being around him, you would soak something up. You would soak something up, and whatever it is that it makes Clapton Clapton, you know, you may get that tinge, you know, by taking lessons from him. He goes, who knows what he would do? I mean, he might. I don't know. Maybe you just sit there with him and just noodle around with him or something. Both kind of noodling around. But who knows? Because what is it that makes him Clapton? I don't know. But maybe he knows. You know, but maybe you would, by osmosis, you'd pick up on it in some way. Yeah, I believe you would. I believe I would. Because I could certainly hit the notes. I mean, I could play. But it's, you know, it doesn't sound like Clapton. Nobody, you know, so it's something else. It's something he has. It's the context, you know. It's his perspective. It's more than just you know, plucking a note on a guitar. It's the whole psychic package that he has somehow. And he may convey that to you. He might not even teach playing the guitar. He might teach, you know, your attitude, and how do you feel about playing, sounding so great? And how do you feel about people saying, "Oh, this is amazing sound you've got," and how are you able to handle that? He might go into the whole psychology of being Clapton. You know, what's the psychology of being quote unquote Clapton? And teach you how to get comfortable with that mindset, rather than teaching you to play the guitar. I mean, that would be more valuable to me. You know, I can play the guitar, you know, used to, for sure. But I couldn't play like Clapton. and because I didn't have the mindset. I didn't have the psychology to do it. You know, the slow hand. They say they play slow hand style. What's that, slow hand? It's something like he's not playing. What he does is he kind of sort of seems to be leaving out everything except what he's playing is what he's leaving out of something, of a beautiful. He's hearing something like total, and he's just leaving out a little bit of that to kind of like give you the edges of the totality of something. You know, it's like that. He somehow has inverted it into a certain way that's such that it's the notes that he leaves out. You can hear those also, kind of. It's amazing. It's completely different. It's a whole different thing. So it's a different psychology that he has. And somehow this resonates with your really musical. It resonates. And it just sounds so beautiful because somehow you're hearing the rest of it, or you're feeling what he's not playing. Whereas everyone else is trying to jam in all these notes and say, "Listen to what I am playing." Whereas Clapton is saying, "Listen to what I'm not playing. Listen to what I'm not playing." He's like a Buddhist master, sort of like a musician. Listen to what I'm not saying. Yeah, the Buddhist master would be saying, "Listen to what I'm not saying." Clapton says, "Listen to what I'm not playing." But he keeps your attention by what, you know, by what he's playing. But he's doing that so he can listen to what he's not playing. There's something like that. You know, it's really, really amazing. That's why it doesn't matter, you can take lessons for 50 years, you still can't, if you don't get that, you're still not going to sound like Clapton, or you know, no. And I don't listen to him anymore because it's frustrating. It's just like, you just say, "Oh my gosh, I want to go back to music, but I know if I do, it'll just waste my time because I don't have the..." You know, but maybe I'll go back and take lessons from Clapton. I might do that. Yeah, it's possible. If Clapton said, "I'll give you lessons and I'll be your, you can be my protege and I'll teach you, I'll bring you into playing like I play." Yeah, I might do it. I might do that. If some, you know, Buddhist master said, you know, I'll you be my protege, and I will show you how, I will bring you into how to speak, how to be in the world, so such that you're what you're saying is really helping others hear what you're not saying, everything that you're not saying. Totality, all the totality there. So you're not in the way of that. You're getting out of the way. You're still here in the world, but in such a way as everyone gets this feeling of what you're not saying, like Clapton. It's what he's not playing that you're hearing. So it's Buddhist. So it's not what they're not. It's what they're not saying that you're hearing. What they're not doing that they're doing. It's like that. So they've somehow mastered that whole that. They're like that. Their presence is like that. So yeah. It would be great to be a protege like that, if it's possible, you know. Clapton's tone, his tone, everything is just, it's like honey. I mean, holy cow. Got a lot of people interested in electric guitars for sure, but unfortunately nobody else really could ever play like him. So I ended up listening to massive decades and decades and decades of listening to guitar work. And well, for what, you know, for what? A waste of time. From all these other guitarists, you hear Clapton, that's good enough, that's it. You don't need to listen to anything else, actually. Waste of time. It's like Dion. Have you heard him sing? That's a good enough. Like, why spend 40 years listening to a bunch of vocalists and you know, for what? Or have you heard George Jones? I'll share my world with you. Song by George. I'll share my world with you. There's a number of versions of that. But holy cow! You know the pacing. And the slowness and the relaxedness and the gentleness and da, 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 da. You hear that and it's just like, okay, I don't need to listen to anything else. It's just you can hear everything that's not being sung and played and everything. It sort of opens it. It's a wide open door to some sort of vastness. Wide open door to some vastness, and they're inviting you into the vastness. They're not saying, listen to me, they're saying, listen to what's beyond me. Don't listen to the I, which is a label for what doesn't exist. Listen to what does exist, or listen to what is, not to a label for the belief that there's something that isn't that there's some absence, a label for the for a non-existent absence. Listen to what is. Get your mind off these labels. Get your mind off these labels. So, if you're helped by some Tibetan or just Buddhist masters, let's say, well, you say, what a very, how great, very grateful for this this help? And they would say, well, we're very grateful that you're willing to be helped. People, those who are really, really great at something, they want the rest of us to be that great, because really they're enjoying what they do. It's just they realize, hey, if you could play this way, it'd be great. So they want you to be able to be like that. But so they're happy too that there's some that are receptive enough to listen, to be helped, that they're happy for that. Absolutely. So you're affording them an opportunity that's probably bigger than the opportunity they're affording you in some ways. They have the opportunity to mentor someone along that will be helpful to many others. And that's, what could make them happier than that, really? I mean, that's fabulous from their standpoint. Or being mentored, like being mentored by Jesus, something like that. Or both. Really, I'll take all the Dharma kings. Be mentored, have therapy with one of them each day. Seven of them. Well, that's one day a week you get to be mentored by one of them, right? Each day of the week, a different one, different flavors of tea. In that case, a little bit. Manjushri, Padmasambhava, Longchenpa, Jambyan, Khenchi, Chogyi, Lodro, Jesus, Anandamayi, Mahan, Rama, Maharshi. So that would be great to be mentored by one of them each day. I don't know if I could handle two on one day. Yeah, Clapton on guitar. He might just say, "Don't even play guitar." Okay, lesson starts now. Where's the guitar? No guitars. I'm not going to use guitars in my teaching. You're going to teach me guitar, but with no guitars? Yeah. I said, "How do you do that?" And he said, "Well, it's an attitude. It's the attitude I play with that you're hearing. So I'm going to teach you that attitude." And you say, "Oh, yeah. Okay." Okay, well, bug just wanted to try to go in my ear, but the headphones blocked it. That's good. All right. So, yeah, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Buddhists, masters, and our Dharma kings, Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, Ram Maharshi, and Of course, Jesus. And we thank all of you for watching and listening. And we just remember, hit the 3-wood off the tee. You know, don't go 100% right now. Don't push yourself too much. Be humble. Be simple. Don't try to buy your way out of misery. Stay focused on your practice. Stay confident. You already have the answer that you're looking for. It's wow. All right. There you go. Very great. That's it for this one. Wow. I'll try to stop it. I tried, but it didn't want to stop, so let me try again. Very great. Wow, 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 and wow.